In today's session, we are going to learn about milling cutters, the classification of milling cutters and the types of milling cutters and various milling operations, work holding devices and tool holding devices, and also fixtures, usage of fixtures on a milling machine. A milling cutter, as we have already discussed in the last session, you can see here, milling cutters are revolving tools having one or more cutting edges of identical shape, equally spaced on the circumference of the cutter. The teeth are equally spaced on the periphery of the cutter. So, milling cutters may be classified as according to the constructional features of the cutter. The milling cutters can be classified as solid cutter, tipped solid cutter and inserted teeth cutter. So, the constructional features of the cutter, we can have a solid cutter, tipped solid cutter and inserted teeth. You can see a solid cutter here. And this is also a solid cutter. The solid cutters appear like this, which can be directly clamped on the arbor. So, this is how we can understand. Now, you can see the diagram. This diagram depicts an inserted teeth cutter. The teeth are inserted onto the core. So, this is how this cutter is called an inserted teeth cutter. So, depending on the constructional features, we can also have inserted teeth type, that is the third type. Here is another diagram, you can see the inserted teeth on the periphery. These are specified by the diameter of the cutter and the width of the cutting edge and the height of the cutting edge, etc. So, this is how we can understand depending on the constructional features. Now, second classification is according to the relief characteristics of the cutter teeth. So, what is the relief given to the cutter teeth? Accordingly, the cutters are named as profile relieved cutter and form relieved cutter. We have two types, profile relieved and form relieved. Profile relieved means what? The cutting edge is relieved so as to get the required shape on the workpiece. You can see this diagram. These are profile relieved. So, the profile on the cutting edge will be obtained on the workpiece. Here is the workpiece. This is the cutter. When it rotates over the workpiece, it leaves the required surface on the workpiece. This is what is called profile relieved cutter. Any required profile that should be brought on the milling cutter. Now, the second form is form relieved cutters. Form relieved means the required form which is to be obtained on the work surface. Like we should have a concave surface and a convex surface and a curved surface, etc. Here you can see the such cutters. This is a form cutter, which is a convex type of cutter which leaves the concavity on the work surface. This is a concave type of cutter which leaves the convexity on the surface. This is a line type radial curve which is obtained on the surface of the cutter. So, here these are specified by again what is the diameter of the concavity or convexity and what is the line radius, etc. So, this is how the second classification of milling cutters can be understood. Now, the third classification being according to the method of mounting the cutter. So, how the cutter is mounted? Accordingly, the milling cutters are classified as arbor type cutter, B shank type cutter and C facing type cutter. So, the cutters are fixed on the arbor, then they are called arbor type cutters. You can see this diagram here. This is a cutter which is having a central hole and a keyway which can be clamped directly on the arbor. This is called, we all know obviously, it is a slab mill. So, this is a arbor type of milling cutter. The second type of milling cutter is shank type. That means the shank type, before going to that, we will go to some other types of cutters. You can see here, this is a face milling cutter and a side milling cutter also. These two cutters are also having the central hole with a keyway. These cutters are also clamped on the arbor. So, these are specified by the internal diameter and the external diameter and the width of the cutter. So, these cutters are specified so. Now, the arrangement of using these cutters is shown. You can see here in this diagram, these cutters, the side milling cutters and face milling cutters are also, they are fixed on the arbor of the machine. You can see here, this is a spindle, this is a yoke, this is arbor, they are fixed on the arbor. So, hence these types of cutters are called arbor type cutters. Another diagram you can also see, where the cutters are fixed on the arbor for machining action. So, these are all depending on the where they are connected. So, this is another diagram, you can see where the cutters are connected to the arbor again. This is a cutter cutting the required teeth on the workpiece. This is a blank of the workpiece. So these are all different types of arbor cutters. Now we will go to the shank type cutters. You can see the diagram, shank type cutter. Shank type cutters are of basically two types. One is taper shank, another is straight shank. Usually the end mills will be having such type of shape, the taper shank and parallel shank, straight shank. These cutters are having edges on the periphery as well as on the front end. Usually end mills are of shank type cutters. So for fixing them in the spindle, we have an arrangement. You can see here, this is an end mill which is fixed in the adapter, and the adapter is in turn fixed in the spring collet body, and the spring collet body is connected to the spindle by a threaded draw bolt, and this is a nut for fixing this adapter. So here for straight shanks we can use this adapter and spring collet body. So this is how the shank type cutters can be fixed. You can also see these diagrams. This is a taper shank cutter and this is a straight shank cutter, and you can see this collet diagram here. This is the collet which can be fixed directly into the spindle for holding the cutters or the adapters of suitable taper. Now this is a collet, this is a nut. So for fixing such type of cutters we use these collet elements. So this is how we can understand how a taper shank and a straight shank cutters are there. So this diagram also shows us how a straight shank cutter is in action. You can see this is connected to the head assembly and this is machining. So this is how we can understand what is a type of straight shank and parallel shank. So in the face milling cutter also you can see, this is a face milling operation. The cutter is connected to the spindle. This is a workpiece. It is cutting the surface and removing the material. So that is how the third type of cutter, facing type of cutter, we can understand. Face type milling cutter. This is a face type milling cutter which is directly fixed to the stub arbor. Stub arbor, we all know it is a short arbor which is not having its other end. It is something like a cantilever. So the stub arbor holds this facing type cutter and it faces the surface. So this is the third type of cutter we have. And we can see one such cutter in action in this diagram. This, you can see this face milling cutter, and this is the workpiece. This is machining the surface. So this is a short arbor, stub arbor. This is how the work is fixed on the machine. So this is one kind of action where a face milling cutter is used. Now fourth classification being according to the direction of rotation of the cutter, whether it is a right hand rotational cutter or left hand rotational cutter. So how we can differentiate between a right hand rotational cutter and left hand rotational cutter? You can see here, when you see from the end of the cutter, when the cutter rotates in the anti-clockwise direction, it is a right hand rotational cutter. When the cutter rotates in the clockwise direction, it is a left hand rotational cutter. This is how we can differentiate between a right hand rotational and a left hand rotational cutters. Now the fifth classification being according to the direction of helix of the cutter teeth. So in what form this helix is generated? Accordingly, we have three types: parallel or straight teeth cutter, and right hand helical cutter, left hand helical cutter. So we have parallel or straight teeth cutter, right hand and left hand helical cutters. You can see parallel cutters. These are all the teeth which are parallel to the axis of the cutter. In this diagram, all the cutting edges are parallel. Hence, it is called parallel type of cutter, parallel teeth cutter. Now this kind of diagram which shows us the teeth are not parallel to the axis, they are making some angle, hence it is a helical teeth cutter, it is not parallel. So these are all some types of cutter having helixes which are either straight or at an angle to the axis of the cutter. Now the sixth classification being according to purpose or use of the cutter, we have standard milling cutter and special milling cutter. So the purpose for which the cutter is used, accordingly we have two types of cutters, the standard milling cutters and the special type of milling cutters. So almost all cutters we generally use in our mechanical field are standard milling cutters only. Special purpose type of milling cutters are used whenever a special type or complex type of work is to be taken up. Now A standard milling cutter is a conventional type of milling cutter whose dimensions such as cutter diameter and width, diameter of center hole, width and depth of keyways, etc. are standardized. So this is how we can understand what a standard milling cutter is. You can, I once again repeat it here, its cutter diameter and the width of the cutter, the diameter of center hole, the width and depth of keyways, the keyway width and depth as well as. All these things are standardized in that particular type of milling cutter. Hence, the name is given to a standard milling cutter. Now, the second type is a special milling cutter. We will try to understand where it is used. A special milling cutter is designed to perform special operations, which may be the combination of several standard operations. The cutters may have standard or non-standard dimensions. I repeat once again, a special milling cutter is designed to perform special operations, which may be the combination of several standard operations. For example, we may have to go for a surface milling, and then angular milling, and then T-slot cutting, and then narrow groove cutting, so and then a profile cutting, profile milling, which is called. So to have all these kinds of types of milling operations, we will be using a particular specially prepared milling cutter. So here combination, it is only one single eye is to be used. The cutters may have standard or non-standard dimensions. So as per the requirement of the user, we may have the cutter designed in that fashion. So in the market, the available cutters are standard cutters. Whenever we need a particular cutter, we have to order for it. Now, the standard milling cutters, how they are classified? There are many types of standard milling cutters. They are classified as plain milling cutter. Firstly, we have a plain milling cutter, a light duty plain milling cutter, a heavy duty plain milling cutter, and a helical plain milling cutter. So we have basically three types of plain milling cutters: a light duty, heavy duty, helical. So this cutter, you can see in this diagram, is a light duty milling cutter. So the light duty or heavy duty depends on the width of the cutter and also the helix angle. Here the cutting edges are parallel, therefore they cannot take up heavy cuts, therefore it is a light duty milling cutter. So when the width of the cutting edges is more and moreover they are helical to the axis, they can take deeper cuts and they can machine at a higher rate. So one such milling cutter, heavy duty milling cutter, you can see in this particular figure. These are the helical edges, which are cutting edges which are not parallel to the axis, they are making some angle. Hence they are called heavy duty milling cutters. We have the second type of milling cutters, standard milling cutters. The second type being the side milling cutter. The side milling cutter, plain side milling cutter, staggered teeth side milling cutter, half side milling cutter, and interlocking side milling cutter. We have basically four types of side milling cutters. So which take up the surface, machining the surfaces of which are sideways. Now you can see this diagram. Here is a side milling cutter which is able to mill the face as well as the sides. You can also see the side cutting edges and also the face cutting edge. On the other side also, you may, if you have another cutting edge, then it is called a side milling, full side milling cutter. If you don't have on one side the cutting edge, then it is called off side milling cutter. So by using this type of cutter, simultaneously three surfaces can be milled at one time. So that is the advantage with this type of cutter. Now you can see the helical milling cutters, the staggered milling cutter, staggered teeth, the teeth having staggeredness. You can see the staggeredness in the end view. One teeth is not in line with the other teeth, the cutting edges are different. That means in a hacksaw, we might be observing such type of staggeredness. Staggered teeth we will be finding on a cutting power hacksaw. So in the same fashion, the teeth are also cut in this fashion. The advantage of this one is we can have more chip space, so that at a higher amount material is removed and the chip removal rate also will be high. So that is the advantage with this staggered type of milling cutters. Now in this diagram you can observe an inserted teeth milling cutter. Interlocking type of side milling cutter. You can have the face cutting edge and the side cutting edge, and these two cutting edges of same widths are interlocked. What is the advantage of this interlocking? using as it is, you can have very wider areas which can be milled at an accurate rate. So if the widths are a bit wider, then simultaneously we can have the milling of the width at an accurate rate. If needed, the interlocking system provides us an arrangement of spacing collars by using which we can also increase the width. So for wider gaps, if they are to be machined, then interlocking system enables us to fix some collars in between and then spacers in between, and then the width can be adjusted. That is the advantage of this interlocking type of milling cutter. So the sectional view of the interlocking milling cutter also you can view in this particular diagram. So this is how they are interlocked. The space can be adjusted by keeping some spacers in between. So they have side cutting edges and face cutting edges. In fact, they are two off side milling cutters. We can say two off side milling cutters, they are interlocked. So this is how we can understand how many types of side milling cutters are there. Then third classification being the metal slitting saw. So the metal slitting saw means it is a round band saw like thing, which is a milling cutter having staggered teeth again, which is used to part off the material or to have a narrow slot on the surface. So for those purposes, this kind of metal slitting slag is used. There are basically two types of metal slitting slags: plain metal slitting slag and staggered teeth metal slitting saw. So plain metal slitting saw, you can see the diagram here, the teeth can be a planed one or a staggered one. In fact, a staggered one will remove more material or more space is available to us. So that is the relative advantage between the two. So we have the slitting saws like this. The fourth classification being the angle milling cutter. The milling cutters are not straight, but they are cut or manufactured in an angular fashion to have the required angle cut on the surface of the workpiece. So we have two basic types of angle milling cutter: side angle milling cutter, double angle milling cutter. To one side the angle is given and which is obtained on the workpiece. You can see this diagram. This shows us that it is a double angle. Here is one angle, here is another angle. So both angles, so total it is included angle. So one of the main specifications of this double angle milling cutter is the included angle between the two. It generally ranges from about 45 degrees to 100 degrees. So that is the usual range of the included angle between the two. So instead of having this included angle on both sides, we can just have the angle on one side it will be straight, then we can get the required shape and angle on the surface. Then it is called a single angle milling cutter. Then the fifth classification being an end mill. So an end mill, what is an end mill? We have already talked about an end mill, and in the some time back we have seen a taper shank and a parallel shank the milling cutters, wherein we have observed on the face as well as on the end also, and we have the cutting edges. That's why it is called an end milling cutter. So end milling cutters are of three types: taper shank end mill, straight shank end mill, and shell end mill. So the shank type, which is a tapered one and a straight one, and the shell end mill, these are the three basic types. You can see this diagram. In this diagram you are seeing it is a straight shank, it is an end mill, but which is not having any shank portion. It is directly clamped on the arbor. So it is a shell end milling cutter, we can call it. So it is directly clamped on the arbor, it has no shank portion. So if you want to see the shank portion, you can see this diagram. This is a T slot milling cutter, this is a shank portion and this is the cutting edge. In fact, this particular tool is used for T slot milling on the work tables. Usually we observe these T slots on the work tables of various machines. So the T slot is cut by this kind of tool. So a T slot milling cutter also will have teeth on its periphery, and it is of shank type. The teeth may be either staggered or straight. You can see the T slot milling cutter where the teeth are staggered, and this is a dovetail slot milling cutter. So for getting the dovetail surfaces for guideways, usually we observe the guideways to be in dovetail fashion on a lathe machine and on any other machine. You can find commonly, most commonly observed guideway is a dovetail cut one, So the dovetail cutting also is possible with this type of dovetail slot milling cutter, and this is the T slot milling cutter which gives T slots. Now you can also observe this diagram wherein a T slot is cut by the end mill cutter. You can see this milling cutter, and this is the shank portion held in the spindle. So it can be either a vertical machine or on a horizontal machine. If it is a horizontal machine, it is an R bar. If it is a vertical machine, directly from the spindle, it is being suspended. So this is how the T slot is being cut on the surface. This diagram shows us how a dovetail guideway is being machined, is being obtained. You can see the dovetail milling cutter, and this leaves the space. This is, you can see this cut particular profile is being obtained by using this type of cutter. This is a vertical milling machine, and this is the workpiece. So next is wood rough keyway milling cutter. So we all know how a wood rough key is being made. It is made on a limited surface for a limited length on a shaft. You can see this particular diagram. This is the shaft on which you are having the keyway for a short length, and for that we have this kind of cutter, which is again having a shank portion which is held in the spindle, and this is these are the teeth. It resembles a T-slot milling cutter, but the teeth may be helical or straight or staggered, so which is used here to have this particular type of wood rough keyway. So this is how this is being machined. A wood rough keyway is obtained. Then the next cutter being the fly cutter. Fly cutter is basically a single type of milling cutter, single cutting edge, single point cutting edge. Why it is used? In emergency, when there is no milling cutter available, then we can go for this fly milling cutter, and this is used for getting the required contour on the surface. You can see in this diagram, the required contour will be obtained on the surface. The fly milling cutter is fixed to the R bar by means of locking screws, and the cutter rotates and then removes the material and leaves the required surface on the workpiece. Now the next classification being formed cutters. Formed cutter. We have some types of formed cutters. The first being convex milling cutter and concave milling cutter, corner rounding milling cutter, gear cutter and thread milling cutter. So we have basically five types: convex, concave, corner rounding and gear cutter and thread milling cutter. So what is a convex and a concave milling cutter? You can see this diagram. This is a convex milling cutter, you can see here. When this cutter rotates on the workpiece, it leaves obviously a concavity on the surface. This is a concave milling cutter. When this cuts the material, these are all the cutting edges. When this cuts the material, it leaves the convexity on the work surface. So the required form is obtained on the tool first, and then when the tool is used, the required shape is obtained. You can see the photographs of these cutters. The first one being a convex milling cutter, the second one being a concave milling cutter, and the third one being a radial milling cutter, line radius milling cutter, wherein it leaves only for a particular area a radial surface, curvature on the surface. It is not full. So for that quarter portion or half portion having that curvature, we can use this type of cutter. So that is how we can observe the cutters. So this is a gear cutter. We can see this is a cutter which is used for gear cutting on the periphery of the workpiece. This is also fixed on the R bar having a central hole and a keyway. So the gear teeth you can observe here, and they are on the periphery. So when this rotates, a particular indexing is done, and thereby the gear teeth are being cut on the work surface. So these are some types of cutters, and the last being thread milling cutter. What is a thread milling cutter? A thread milling cutter cuts threads on the surface. You can see this is a thread milling cutter. Of course, this is a shank portion. This can be fixed to the R bar in the usual process. This is also a taper shank one. This is a straight shank one. At the front end, the milling cutter will have teeth over its periphery. These are the cutting edges. When this rotates inside the workpiece, it leaves the threads on the surface. Whether it is an external surface or internal surface, it can have the threads cut on the surface. These two are called thread milling cutters. So this is how we can see different types of milling cutters. Now we try to understand what are the various parts and how are they named, what is the function of each part on a milling cutter. In fact, the study of all these things is what is called nomenclature of a milling cutter. So we can see this diagram. In this particular diagram, some portion of the milling cutter is shown. The direction of rotation is given here. We start from A. What is this A? This A is the relief angle. Now you can see the cutting edge. This is the cutting edge. The cutting edge is H, which is shown here. In fact, this is the edge which cuts the material. The basic difference between a single point cutting tool and a milling cutter is the cutting tool which we use on lathe is a single point cutting tool which has only one direction. But here the milling cutter rotates over the surface. Therefore, the cutting edge tries to come over the surface. Therefore, we have to provide certain reliefs. So basically, this is the cutting edge. When it rotates over the workpiece, then we should leave some relief. So this A, which is the angle between the cutting edge and the land surface, which is extended, is what is called the relief angle. This relief angle is to be given. Now we come to B. B is the primary clearance angle. Primary clearance angle. What is the primary clearance angle? Because the milling cutter is rotating over the cutting edge, when the chip is removed from the surface, this will come in contact with the machined surface. Therefore, this surface should not be in touch with the work surface. That's why if this is straight like this, this will be in intersection with the, this will be intersecting with the work surface. Therefore, we should give some front clearance, primary clearance angle. Then as it is rotating further, we should give secondary clearance angle also. That is given by, described here as C. So the primary clearance, secondary clearance, both are required for a milling cutter. Firstly, basically it is a relief that is given to the milling cutter. Then D, which is the angle between the back of the tool surface and the front face of the tool surface. If the lines are drawn, the angle between these two lines is what is called lip angle, the lip angle of the cutter, that is described here as D. Now you can see E here. E is the angle which is called rack angle. Rack angle means what? The material is being removed by this cutting edge. There should be a space provided for the chip to come out. So this is how the rack angle is being given. You all know very much about the various rack angles in your previous years, back rack angle, side rack angle, etc. So this is one radial rack angle, we can say, and this is the angle between the cutter face and the axis of the cutter. So this is described here as E. So this F, this is a tooth depth. So the depth of each tooth is measured here as F. Then G, G is the land. Land is, what is the land? The distance between the cutting edge and the back of the tooth, which is given there to avoid intersection of the cutting edge with the work surface. If this land is not given, not provided, there is a possibility that the cutting edge may get jammed into the workpiece. For such relief, we will give this land. But the land should not be so broader. There should be a compromise. So the land G is one of the specifications of the milling cutter. So this is how we can understand various elements that are existing on a milling cutter. So H is a milling cutting edge, H. I is the back surface of the cutting tool, that is milling cutter. J is a gash portion where the chip is being obtained. This is a place provided between the front surface and the back of the previous tooth. So that is the area where the chip is getting accumulated. This is a gash portion, we call it and described here as J. So these are some of the terms which we come across while describing a milling cutter. That's why it is called the nomenclature of a plane milling cutter. Thus we have seen a plane milling cutter's nomenclature. Now let us go to the side milling cutter. A side milling cutter, helical milling cutter. Helical milling cutter means what? We have helix cut on the surface. The cutting edges are not straight. They are at some angle to the axis of the cutter. We can see the front portion and the end view also. These are different cutting edges, and in the front view The helical cutting edges are seen like this. E describes here the helix angle. The cutting edge makes this angle with the axis of the cutter. F describes the width of the cutter. Now we can expand one such cutting edge and we can see in the magnified form here. So again A is a cutting edge here, and D is a lip angle, and it is a front clearance angle, that is C. When the cutter is coming in contact with the workpiece should be avoided with interaction intersection with the surface. And B is the land, and the front clearance, the back rake angle also, of course, it is provided here. So this is how all clearance angles, rake angles are needed to be provided on any milling cutter, because it is basically used for removing chips on the work from the workpiece. Now this is a plain milling cutter, a side milling cutter we can call it. So these are the side cutting edges, and this will also be able to mill the side surfaces, the nomenclature of a side milling cutter. So how a side milling cutter can be nomenclated, what are its important factors? Already we have studied much about the plain milling cutter. In addition, what we have in a side milling cutter, so you can see the side milling cutters, one of the views, these are the cutting edges. Now in a side milling cutter, as it is cutting the side cutting edges, we have to give side clearance angles, because these are the cutting edges which may come in contact with the side surfaces that to be relieved. Therefore A is called side clearance angle, and B is the cutter width, and the overall width of the cutter is this one. So the side clearance angles, primary as well as secondary, are must for a side cutting side milling cutter. And you can see this one such cutter, one edge here, one cutting edge which is seen in the magnified form. Again we have this land, and also the back rake angle and the flint clearance angles, etc. So basically the clearance angles are very much required, and you have already learnt about these clearance angles and back rake angles, etc., in your previous classes on a single point cutting tool. The concept is very much same. The cutter materials, the common materials that are used for making a milling cutter are carbon steel, and we have a high speed steel, HSS we call it. We have sintered carbides, which can be just tipped on the surface of a core disc, which is called a cutter basically. Then we have ceramics, and we have stellates. So these are some of the cutter milling materials. We have this carbon steel and high speed steel, which are most commonly used. Whenever we need to go for milling hard materials, we have to go for sintered carbide materials, which are to be brazed in the form of tips on the surface of a basic core milling cutter. And the ceramics also will be brazed, and stellates. So this is how, depending on the workpiece strength, we can go from carbon steel, high speed steel, to even sintered carbides, ceramics, and also stellates. Now various tool holding devices. So most commonly used tool holding devices, how they will be on a milling machine. Now you can see here, there are several methods of supporting and rotating milling cutters with the machine spindle, depending on different designs of the cutters. So it depends on the design of the cutter. Based on the design of the cutter, we design the tool holding device. That is how it is to be understood. So the tool holding devices differ from machine to machine, and from cutter to cutter. But in most commonly used tool holding devices, we must learn. The following are the most commonly used tool holding devices. Arbor is the primary element which holds the tool, and the collet, adapters, a spring collet. These are the basic elements which are used on milling machine to hold the tools. Now firstly, we try to learn about an arbor. You can see this diagram. Here it shows the overarm of the milling machine. It is a horizontal machine. Now you can see the arbor. This is the front yoke, the back yoke. It is connected to the spindle. This arbor holds the tool. You are seeing the overall view of how a tool is held on an arbor. So these are spacing collars for adjusting the cutters. So this is a nut for adjusting this arbor, and also for adjusting the cutters. So this is how an arbor overall, in an overall view, can be observed. So the arbor is the basic element which holds the cutters. Let us try to understand what are the various elements involved in arbor. Now you can see the spacers. Here is the spindle. We have a cutter here. Wherever it is required in this line, it can be adjusted by using these spacers. Spacers are of different widths. You can adjust them. And this is a drive key. This is arbor nut for fixing it. Now you can see here the sectional view. This is the shank portion of the spindle. The arbor is fixed. This is the cutter. This is a key, spacing collars, and this is a nut. So when you tighten the nut, this cutter will be fixed, and now it is ready now for action. So this is the assembly of an arbor. The arbors usually may be of short type or long type. Long type arbors will be fixed in between the two yokes. Short arbor is called stub arbor. You can also see this diagram. This diagram shows how an arbor is fixed to the spindle. We have usually spindle to the machine head. Now the spindle to the spindle, the arbor is attached by a draw bolt. You can see the draw bolt here, and this to this arbor again the spacing collars, the shaft is attached by the driving dogs. This is one arrangement of attaching the arbor to the spindle. Now the second type of work holding devices are called collets and adapters. You can see the collet here. Collet is an element which resembles a spindle. Generally a machine will have a spindle which corresponds to a particular taper, and if an arbor or a tool is not corresponding to that particular taper, then the collet is used there. This collet is fixed in the spindle, and in this collet we can fix the required arbor or the suitable cutter. So the arbor, the cutter, the collet is having a taper. Generally this taper is of Morse tape. Now you can see this as adapter. This is an adapter where usually the shank type tools will be held. So parallel shank type tools will be usually held in the adapter, and this adapter will go into the spindle. Either it can be directly clamped to the spindle or it can be bolted to the spindle. So these are the two basic elements which are in use when a particular type of milling cutter is required to be used. So an adapter is used only when a parallel shank type milling cutters are required to be used. Now you can see the combination, the photographs. You can see this is a spindle, and you can see the collet here, and this is a nut. So the nut is fixed, and the collet for holding the required tool having a shank, and this part, this arbor assembly, this can be directly fixed to the spindle. So this is totally called a collet assembly. Collet, these three elements are called collets. These are used for holding tools of shank type. Now how these are used, you can see here a spring collet body. This is in fact a spring collet body. The spring collet body is being connected to the spindle by means of a draw bolt. One is a draw bolt. This is a spring collet body, which you can see by photograph here. And this is the three is a nut, and four is a adapter. So this you can see the adapter in which you can fix the end mill. So the end mill is fixed here, and by fixing this nut over this, the slits are there. You are seeing in this diagram the slits. It is being slitted, and the slits will come together and hold the tool like this. So by using a nut and a spring collet body which is being connected to the spindle and an adapter, how an end mill can be fixed, we can very easily understand by looking at this particular diagram. Now the bolted cutters, directly the cutters will be bolted to the spindle. You can see this diagram. This is a spindle. Now these are the driving dogs. This is a cutter, face milling cutter, and this cutter is directly bolted to the spindle. No other intermediate element is in use. So this is how we can just see how a cutter is bolted to the spindle also. Sometimes the cutter will be screwed on the spindle. Now you can see this type of cutter which is having a cutting edges on its periphery, and the spindle at its front end will be having teeth. It is just directly screwed onto the front end of the spindle, and it can be in use. This is also used for introducing it into the narrow gaps and small holes, etc. So this is how the cutter can be screwed onto the spindle body also. Now we see, we have studied about various tool holding devices. Now we go to various work holding devices. The work holding devices are basically clamps, T bolts. So how the T-bolts and flanks appear, you can see this diagram. This is a T-bolt for fixing in this T-slot on the table. We use this T-bolt for fixing the workpiece. So these are various nuts and collars which are in use. You can see how they are used, and using a particular strip you can just fix this workpiece on the table. This is the workpiece. Two is a workpiece, one is a strap used, and this is a T-bolt. So this is a clamp. In fact, one is a clamp. Clamps can be of different shapes. We will have a clamp, U-tape, U-shaped clamp also, which we can observe here. You can see U-shaped clamp. So the basic elements of work holding are T-bolts and clamps. You can see in this diagram one such arrangement. You observe here, this is one kind of clamp, which where again a T-bolt is used, and this is for fixing the workpiece, and this is a tool. So this diagram depicts how a T-bolt and clamp is used. This is another diagram showing us how the workpiece is fixed onto the table. See, the table is having T-slots, and you have this T-slots. Similarly, we can also go for the angle plates. Angle plates are second type of elements for holding the workpiece. So having angle plates are of different shapes. These are perpendicular angle plates by using which you can just exert pressure on the workpiece, and workpiece can be clamped. This diagram shows us the swiveling type of angle plate, wherein one surface can be swivel in any fashion so as to adhere to the required surface of the work surface. All the work surfaces may not be flat, may not be perpendicular, they may be angular also. In such case, this type of angular plate is swiveling type angular plate is very much applicable. Then we can see this angle plate in this particular diagram. This angle plate, this is the angle plate, and this is another angle plate for fixing this workpiece. This is how the machining is done. This is a face milling cutter which is cutting the surface. So this is the angle plate. Again, a T-bolt is used here. So this is how, by using angle plates, we can take up the work. Next is V-blocks. What are V-blocks? What is the importance of V-block? A V-block is used for holding usually round size shaped work pieces. Whenever some slotting action, keyway cutting, or a square shaped surface is to be brought on a round surface, then such round work pieces are just clamped on a V-block, and then they are machined. Now you can see this arrangement here. This is a work piece, this is a V-block, and this is being clamped by a brace here and by a screw, and then the workpiece, on the workpiece the machining is now being done. So these V blocks are used for holding the round work pieces. So we can see another arrangement here where a round work piece is used and a V block. You are using an end mill here for cutting the surface and making it into a required rectangular or square shape, and also a straight milling cutter, a plain milling cutter is used of narrow width to have a keyway cut on it. And how this round piece is fixed on the table also, you can see it is again a T-bolt and a clamp. So by using different or combination of elements, we can fix the workpiece. Now the third one being vices. What are the various types of vices? We have plain vice, we have swivel vice, we have tool maker's universal vice. We all know what is a plain vice. In our carpentry shop, fitting shop, you might have observed this so many times. So this has one fixed jaw, another mobile jaw, by using the handle here, and these are the U-ways provided for fixing it to the table by means of T-bolts, and then by fixing the workpiece here you can take up the work. That is a example of a plain vise. A plain vise is directly fixed on the machine table of a milling machine. Then in the plain vise the workpiece is fixed. You can see one such plain vise wherein a workpiece is fixed and the cutter is cutting the material. This is the arrangement of a simple plain vise. This diagram shows us the arrangement. Now second is swivel vise. There is a slight flexibility given to the vise. In the previous vise there was no swiveling action. Now the swiveling action also can be done so that the workpiece can be fixed in any particular position with respect to the plane. Therefore the tool can be held in its own position, workpiece can be moved to the required position. This you can see the circular gradations, so it can be swiveled in this fashion. So by using a swivel vise we can have flexibility given to the workpiece. Now the third being universal vise. So universal vise, the name itself indicates that it has all types of flexibilities that can be offered to the workpiece. You can see the universal vise here. It can be swiveled in a vertical plane, it can be swiveled in a horizontal plane, it can be kept in an angled position. here is the workpiece that can be fixed, and this as a whole, this universal vise is fixed onto the table, and the workpiece can be fixed, and we can have any position that can be fixed. In any position, the work can be fixed, and the milling action can be done. Now, the next being the dividing head. The dividing head is another element which is used for cutting gear teeth on the workpiece for giving indexing. The dividing head offers the mechanism of indexing the workpiece, because some number of teeth are to be cut. So when the workpiece is required to be moved and to what amount it is to be moved, and that is decided by the indexing mechanism. Therefore, a dividing head also is considered as a work holding device. Then we come to milling fixtures. What are various milling fixtures? What is a fixture actually? A fixture comes into use whenever the same type of works are needed to be done, and also in mass quantities. So whenever some bolts or nuts are to be machined in large amounts, so then we can go for some fixtures and then go for milling action. You can see in this diagram one such milling fixture where a tool is held in the arbor. The workpieces which are of complex shape and of different shape, such suitable fixtures are used. The fixture is fixed on the work table, and in the fixture the workpiece is fixed, and then it is machined by keeping the work in that particular required fashion as to what surface is required to be milled. So that is where a fixture comes into action. You can also see in this diagram various types of nuts are being manufactured. Nuts, we are going to slot them. Here in this diagram, the slotting is being done on the workpieces. Various types of such workpieces are kept in this type of fixture. Simultaneously, in mass action, in mass quantities, the parts may be milled. That is the advantage of this fixture. So, this is another diagram showing us how a circular indexing is done on a round piece. You can see this is a slot being done, and at some angle, again another slot is required to be milled by an end milling cutter. Then to what distance, angular position that is to be moved, that is decided by this milling type of fixture. This is called swiveling milling indexing fixture. So this is how we can understand various types of fixtures. Now in this session we have studied about what are various types of milling cutters, classification of milling cutters, types of milling cutters, and various types of work holding devices and tool holding devices, and when fixtures are in use.